Issue 1, Who's Being Buffaloed? Harold Ickes, Deputy White House Chief of Staff, announced his resignation, possibly to head the much lower profile National Park Service. Mr. Robert Novak, syndicated columnist, television commentator, is the position of caretaker to the buffalo, the highest post a liberal will assume in Clinton's second term.
It could be, Gary, but as a matter of fact, I don't think Harold Ickes is going to be running the Park Service. That just
I got that out of the New York Times.
I know.
That's my Bible.
It's absolutely ludicrous. He's going back to New York to be a lawyer again for mob-infested unions. And they want no part of Harold Ickes in this administration. The president faces very mean Republicans on Capitol Hill with investigations. He doesn't want left-wingers in the White House, but he did it with the usual Clinton style. That when you've worked as hard as Harold Ickes did the last 2 years running that campaign, the nuts and bolts of them, he just spits you right out. Didn't bother to call him up. Ickes read it in the newspaper.
That's terrible, Mr. Jeff Cox, former Democratic County Chair and now editor of the Prairie Progressive. What do you think of this possibility of Clinton's second term? Well, are liberals just through?
Well, the interesting thing to me is Janet Reno. I mean, the whole right now we're getting a kind of game going on about whether Reno is going to stay or not. I think there's a strong case for replacing her. I mean, it seems like that time after time the FBI has just been out of control. I mean, her first major act as Attorney General was to order the tear gassing of the poor Branch Davidian children, which was a kind of preview of the Clinton administration's welfare policy, that is, punish the kids to change the behavior of the parents. But then we've had FBI covers up, the Jewell investigations, the handing over of all these documents to the White House. No one's ever explained why the FBI actually did it in handing them over. The problem is that Clinton is likely to replace her with somebody worse. I mean, he needs somebody with some credibility and integrity, and if he appoints somebody with credibility and integrity, he endangers his own administration.
Mm-hmm.
So it'll be very interesting to see what happens on this.
Marlene Perrin is possibly the only person on this panel who voted for President Clinton. what do you think of his shot? Well, I will discuss that later.
Possibly.
Possibly and possibly not.
Right, right.
Let's just say it was lucky that the votes were counted in Iowa, and the polls were open until 9 p.m., and there was plenty of time to vote for Ralph Nader.
Right.
Marlene Perrin, as I was saying, is possibly the only person who voted for President Clinton on this panel. The shoddy way he has treated people, what do you think about that? That Mr. Ickes had to find out about it in the newspapers, and that this massive exodus of people from his administration?
Well, a lot of people in positions like president, corporation executives and so on, treat people in a shoddy manner. I'm not, when you have to operate in a fishbowl, I'm not sure there's any nice way to do it. You might have been a little nicer. I think it's a little early to get over concerned about whether there are going to be liberals in the cabinet or not. I don't know that liberal and conservative means anything anymore. In the days when Pat Buchanan and Ralph Nader both opposed NAFTA, and the conservatives want government to stay away from everybody but women and their doctors, you know, I don't know what liberal and conservative means anymore.
Don't you still mean something?
Oh yeah, I do. It means high taxes and big government, or less government and lower taxes. That's what it's all about. Regulation or not regulation. More power to the states or more power to the federal government. But you raise a very interesting point on Janet Reno.
Mm-hmm.
Because this is an interesting story. She has about as much day-to-day contact running the Justice Department as you
right.
do. I mean, she's totally incompetent. She's not well, but she's honest.
Right.
And she has said, gee, we got scandals, let's have special prosecutors. And they hate that at the White House. And they have given her about 16 hints to quit. She won't quit.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And the position the president is in, he's afraid to fire her because the Republicans suddenly, a couple years ago they were attacking her as an incompetent, now they're attacking her as the font of, they're praising her as the font of integrity, and he is afraid to fire her, and she says she has no intention of quitting. So it's kind of a comic situation.
Well, it sounds comic, but what's going to be the end result?
I mean, there was one. Wasn't Mickey Cantor actually mentioned a week or so ago?
Yeah, he was.
And Mickey Cantor is just as corrupt as he can be. I mean, he's a kind of wheeler dealer fundraiser for the Democratic Party of the soft money persuasion.
Let me defend him. He was the honest. He was the most honest lawyer, lobbyist, operator in Los Angeles. How's that?
Yeah? Okay.
That doesn't sound like it's saying much.
Well, I think this is Clinton's dilemma. I mean, who's he going to appoint? If he appoints somebody who will protect him, it won't look good. And if he leaves Reno, I mean, I think he's in a real dilemma.
Let me tell you somebody he could name.
Is this an exclusive for the Sanders
show? Sure.
Okay.
He could name a very good friend of Hillary's, the first lady's, the governor of Massachusetts, William Weld.
Really? All right, well, you heard it here first, folks, right here on the Sanders Group. William Weld.
Don't bet the ranch on it now.
Well, would William Weld take it?
Yeah, well, I just won a lot of money on the election.
He was devastated by losing the Senate seat in Massachusetts, good. And he's bored. He's bored to tears with the governorship. He's been in it 6 years. How'd you like to be governor of Massachusetts for 6 years? It's boring, and so. And he's kind of a dilettante anyway, and so he might be interested in it.
Right.
Well, that's incredible. Right here, what's going to happen to the other cabinet spots, do you think?
Well, I had thought for sure that the Secretary of State would be former Senate Majority Leader George Mitchell, who has the great asset, he knows nothing whatever about foreign policy. He just, the only thing he's had to do is he screwed up the Northern Ireland thing, the negotiations. But somebody at the White House told me the president seriously is considering naming Sam Nunn, retiring Senator Sam Nunn of Georgia, Secretary of State. That would be a very popular appointment in all kinds of different circles. Right. He's a very competent man. He doesn't want to be Secretary of Defense. He'd like to be Secretary of State, though.
Well, speaking of Southern senators, I heard from an astute political commentator today that the real winner in this election was Trent Lott. Mr. Jeff Cox, what do you think about that?
Well, I think that, you know, that we've got, as I've said sort of ad nauseum, that we're entering a period of one-party government here. I mean, I think that there's broad areas of agreement between the two parties. And the one thing that threatens to destabilize them is the prospect of an indictment of Hillary Clinton. I mean, there's a kind of loose cannon aspect to the rule of law once it's turned loose. And what the Republicans really have no incentive right now to continue this assault on the Clinton administration that was going on.
But they will.
Well, they may, just out of sheer partisan momentum. Mm-hmm. But I think that the one thing, you know, the left is totally marginalized. The Christian right is out of it because the Republican Party consistently betrays them after taking their support. You have a kind of cross-party consensus on prisons and drugs and crime and balancing the budget and welfare.
But Mr. Novak here just elaborated on a whole string of differences between the liberals and conservatives.
I disagree with Professor Cox, but maybe we can agree on this. I think there are three parties.
Okay.
I think there's a Republican Party, of which, believe me, the Christian Coalition is a major part. They are the foot troops.
Electorally.
Yes, and they have influence, too. And the second party is the Democratic Party, which has a lot of influence by organized labor. They're the foot troops of that party. And the third party is the Clinton Party. And Clinton is off on his own thing. Now, one day he said he's for the balanced budget amendment. Did you notice that?
Yeah.
Constitutional amendment.
Oh, yeah.
And then the next day...
We get the time.
The next day, today, he said... He was not for it. He was just not going to oppose it too hard.
Right, right, right.
Well, that's the Clinton party.
Well, yeah, and on my last show, I mentioned that, you know, he had no ideology in this election, and that it was shameful that he ran as a loner, and that's how he got elected.
And that's one of the reasons the Republicans retained Congress, because he gave the American people no reason to vote for a Democratic Congress. None at all.
Or for a Democrat. of any kind, at any level.
Now, why are we all agreeing on everything?
No, not yet. Hold on. By the way, I don't think we all agreed.
Because
when you said higher taxes for the Democrats, isn't it true that the only people who got higher taxes out of the last 4 years were people who made more than $190,000?
Well, people who made more than $190,000 the only people who buy gasoline?
No, 4 cents a gallon doesn't even begin to pay for what we're paying for.
But isn't that higher tax? Isn't that higher tax?
But that's the only tax.
Can I name you another one?
Sure.
For the top 20% of Social Security recipients got higher
that's
taxes.
Right.
Isn't that another
did.
One?
Well, they did.
How can I name the ways?
Marlene Perrin. Let Marlene Perrin. She's an expert on taxes.
Actually.
She does taxes.
And what I was struck by during the campaign was the tax message, Dole's tax message, didn't come through because the largest tax increase in history, quote unquote, did not affect us in terms of the income tax. I had to pay higher gasoline tax. I certainly didn't have to pay any more in income tax, nor did 95% of the people in the country. And you're not... The message of Susan Molinari that if the taxes are decreased, these poor mothers struggling to put food on the table can take a little more time off, baloney. That's so far away from the real lives of people who make 25, 30, 35.
Well, I don't think you're going to see a major tax increase under this. I mean, there have been real differences over the last 5 or 6 years between Democrats and Republicans. I just think they're over now. I mean, the issues that the Christian right is pushing are abortion, school prayer, and federal tuition tax credits. I do not believe that the Republican Party
Have you ever seen the Christian rights, the Christian coalition agenda?
I used to be one.
Have you ever seen their agenda, though?
Yes.
It's got a lot more than those issues.
Well,
it's got lower taxes. It's got deregulation of business. It's got devolution of business.
I don't think the troops care about that.
I think they do. I think you're wrong on that.
Ms. Nomad, for a registered Democrat, you make a pretty good pitch for the Republican Party. But getting back to this thing,
I'm the only registered Democrat in the District of Columbia who voted the straight Republican ticket on November 5th.
Is this a great country or what, folks? No, but what I want to know about this tax business, you see. You know, Bill Clinton did a lot for people like myself who are low income. We got this income tax credit. And I think we should be paying 4 cents a gallon extra on gasoline tax so we can begin to understand how much it's costing us.
Let me tell you what the tax... There's two issues on taxes that permeate and go to the ordinary people. One is the FICA tax. Young people, particularly when they get their first paycheck, they open it up. They say, "Oh my God, what have they done to me?" You know, don't they say that? The young people work for me do that. They say, "Well, I thought I was getting such and such."
But it hasn't changed for quite a few years. The rate hasn't changed.
But it's high. It's extremely high. And that is something that the Democrats refuse to do anything about, and the Republicans, I think, are beginning to get the message that something. The other thing is the IRS. I don't care whether you're making $13,000 a year or $30,000 or $300,000. If you have dealings with the IRS, you hate them because they're arrogant and incompetent.
Well, I have to disagree
a little bit on that because I have had some contact with the IRS and they've been very nice.
Well,
I think
nice.
there are IRS people and there are IRS people.
They're nice
and
to everybody who lives in Iowa.
Well, I've dealt with someone for a client and I was amazed at how nice they were.
I want to ask him about the Dole campaign because he said today that you know, it was absolutely terrible. And, you know, you also said that Dole was picked like the head of the Kiwanis Club. Now, Marlene Perrin happens to be a member of the Kiwanis Club.
Have you been president?
No, I won't do it. That's the way we pick them, though.
That's right. That's the way the Republican Party nominates their candidates.
You try to find out who's dumb enough to take it.
All right. Well, let's let the last word on this to Jeff Cox.
Well, if you want to talk about big government, when are we going to stop spending money on prisons? I mean, if you want to talk about a hemorrhage in the public sector spending and the massive growth of government at every level, you're talking about massive increases in prison expansion. And there's a cross-party consensus on this. The 994 crime bill, which was, until the welfare reform bill, the worst piece of legislation passed in the last 20 years, bailed out the states and counties on this and got the federal government into the business of subsidizing prisons. I think the referendum on jail construction in L.A. which where it was a proposal to build a new jail was defeated massively, may be the tip of the iceberg in terms of a voter revolt against
Let's not build prison. Let's send them all to Iowa.
Okay.
Well, we're the most pleasant.
Thanks a lot.
We're the most pleasant state, and we'll get out on that.
The University of Iowa. How about sending them there?
Issue two, bridge over the Potomac. Well, we had the bridge to the future, the bridge to the past, and it really didn't matter as the incumbents rolled back over the Potomac in the House. Except for the 19 House Republicans who lost their seats to the Democrats thanks to the AFL-CIO targeting, including, I believe, your buddy, B-1 bomber Dornan. Jeff Cox, former Democratic Party chair.
I just have to say, it's about time we had a Hispanic backlash against Republican, veiled Republican race baiting. I mean, you've had this for a long time in Texas, so you have people like, you know, Phil Graham taking liberal positions on issues of immigration and issues of affirmative action. But it seems like it might have hit California and Arizona. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's quite, I think, extraordinary that Bill Clinton carried Arizona.
It wasn't on the Hispanic issue, I guarantee you.
Marijuana.
No, it wasn't marijuana.
You think it was pensions and the Social Security that did it?
Medicare. The whole Medicare.
Well, anyway, as a liberal, I'm hoping for some broad Hispanic backlash here, and I take comfort from the defeat of Bob Dornan. This maybe we're seeing it.
Well,
Dornan was not a killing. It was a suicide.
Yeah.
How so?
Well, he's been in there a long time.
Well, he's not playing with a full deck.
Right.
I mean, anybody who's ever heard him give those speeches on the in the House of Representatives. See, the trouble is, he used to give those speeches before C-SPAN, and nobody saw him. Now his constituents.
Right.
If I were running against him, I'd just take his speeches
and use them.
Mm-hmm. And the other thing was, he ran for president, which was absurd, and he 2 months before the election. He had, for a congressional campaign, he had $8,000.
$8,000. Yeah, but Mr. Novak, you know, these Republicans outspent the Democrats throughout the country. I mean, the amount of money that business poured in, and it was substantial. I called Washington, D.C.
I explained that to you today.
No, I called Washington, D.C. today for the... and found out how much money has been reported to the Federal Election Commission, and the numbers are staggering. The AFL-CIO in the races they lost was outspent on an average of $500,000. Money talks.
Can I explain it to you?
Well,
do you want to know the truth?
Yeah, you got 1 minute. Go. because you're from Washington, you get more than these guys.
It doesn't include the soft money that they mm-hmm. put in. This includes just the contributions and the voter education. The soft money they put in for party development. They put in the money for the party development, and they pour the money into a congressional district. That doesn't get into that. The second thing is that as I told you before, the business roundtable.
No, I know about that.
Divides their money. They're switch hitters.
Well,
they give some to the Democrats, some to the Republicans, because they're not interested in it. Big business is not interested in issues. They're interested in access,
right.
How they can open the door. So that's not the point. But I want to say one other thing. You said that the 19 incumbents lost. I think that's a little exaggerated, because you're probably including Linda Smith and Jack Metcalf from Washington State, who I think have not been defeated. I think they're going to win. And, of course, that isn't a net gain. The net gain is more like probably 10 or 11 seats, right. which is just about the worst gain in the House of Representatives for a reelected president in the history of the country.
Well, but that's because, as
we all agree,
it's
worse than Nixon, worse than Reagan.
You know, as we all said, he ran alone. He had his own party.
I think it's a pretty disappointing result. I agree with you entirely on that. I do think, though, that labor is spent huge sums of money, and not only are they not going to get much in return for their money because their candidates didn't win, it's that they were supporting candidates who don't support the labor movement. I mean, the Clintonite revolution has struck roots in the Democratic Party much deeper than people think. I mean, people still think that there's a New Deal Democratic Party there and that Clinton is something different from this. But if you look at the patterns of influence, the patterns of fundraising, and the patterns, most important of all, of candidate recruitment in the Democratic Party, if you look around the country, you're going to find people who were in positions, Democratic candidates, who basically are very sympathetic to Bill Clinton and not sympathetic to the labor movement. So if labor had won more, I don't think they'd be getting more for their money. I think they need to put their money into Democratic primaries, knocking Clintonite candidates out in the Democratic primary if they want to have some influence in Congress.
I think you will go a little far on that. I think a lot of these people talk a more conservative game in the general election campaigns than they'll vote when they get on Capitol Hill.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's a good, you know, I always like to read Human Events, because their view is that liberals are running everything. And there's this huge liberal establishment, and whenever I get depressed, I go out and I read that, you know, I'm really in charge of everything. But I have
I'm glad you read Human Events.
Oh, I never miss
Human Events.
I never miss Human Events. I've read it since I was a child. But
they got a new editor. Did you notice that?
No.
Pat Buchanan's campaign manager, Terry Jeffrey.
Oh, good.
He's the new editor.
Good.
Yeah, Pat Buchanan's state coordinator in this state, Laura S. Schultes, his brother of the Christian Coalition, was defeated in his re-election to state house. Marlene Perrin, you're a little bit familiar with this race,
Didn't in Iowa, unless I'm mistaken, didn't the Republicans take over the legislature?
Yes, they did.
They did. Mm-hmm. Yes,
there were a few, mm-hmm. however,
they took over the
religious,
state senate.
Yes.
They had been.
That's what I meant.
Yeah,
so
right.
They got both houses.
Right, right.
But there were a few that you'd call, that I call religious right nuts.
Yeah, and name them.
You know, well, Laura
Schulte
and Chuck Hurley.
Yeah.
And
Larry Disney.
The worst. Yeah. The worst lost.
Brian Coon.
Of the
yeah.
Religious
mm-hmm.
right.
The most religious of the religious.
Right. Well, Marlene made a point earlier, again, about the difference between the parties, that the Republicans, at least the way they are today, with the conservative right influence, do want to get in there with the women and their doctors.
That's nonsense.
Marlene, go ahead.
Let me say about abortion. There's nothing that's going to happen on abortion. I mean, what's the campaign's over, Gary? You don't have to give this stuff out. I mean, there's nothing going to happen on abortion. Supreme Court is not going to act on it. There's not going to be a constitutional amendment. You can't have a statute. It is an absolutely inert issue.
And if Doe's been elected, nothing would happen either, because the Republican Party in this country does not intend to criminalize abortion.
But there's nothing. It's a phony issue.
What
about
the state house level?
Nationally, I agree.
You can't ban abortion.
Can't ban abortion. We've got minors having to report.
Is that bad?
I think
70% of the American people agree with that. 70% of the people agree with banning late-term abortions.
Uh-huh.
70% of the people agree with a 24-hour waiting period.
Uh-huh.
But you can't ban abortions.
And when you started 30 years ago in the Chicago Sun-Times, the majority of people in this country were in favor of the Vietnam War, and I was proud to be on the other side of that. So I'm not going to be part of this. Well, just because the majority says one thing, that makes it right.
But
Marlene Perrin, I want to give you the last word on this abortion thing.
Well, I don't think abortion should be part of the political scene, frankly. I'd like to see it go away. I don't think anything will happen nationally, but I think it will be chipped away at state level.
All right, and I'd like to have the last word on the influence of unions in this election. 4 million more union households voted in 96 than in 92. And I'm glad you're smiling, because that's how we got Bill Clinton, and that's how we got these worst of these Republicans out of the House of Representatives. Issue 3, Millennium Melee. Well, it was rumored that Dan Quayle was in Iowa today, possibly to judge a spelling bee, I'm not sure, and Dick Gephardt will be the featured speaker at the Quad Cities Federation of Labor Hall of Fame banquet on December 12th. Is the race for the presidential nomination of 2000 already started? Here we are a week after this past election. Mr. Novak.
Let me say something about that. You made that remark about the spelling bee, and
that's a cheap shot. I apologize.
But let me tell you something that might amuse you. I have an autographed picture from Vice President Quayle when Boris Yeltsin was in Washington. It's the three of us together. That's a hell of a threesome: Yeltsin, Quayle, and me. And he inscribed it, and he spelled my name wrong.
True story. Oh my! Is this another Sanders Group exclusive?
Yes, that's right.
Oh my gosh!
Well, I don't think Vice President Quayle has much support in the party. The interesting thing about 2000 is that on the one party, with the Democrats, used to have great free-for-alls, and you had somebody coming out of Arkansas, like Bill Clinton, out of nowhere to get nominated in 92. Now they've got a guy in Vice President Gore who is in a really solid position. He's going to be hard to dislodge. Mm-hmm. And for the Republicans, it is absolutely wide open. There's not a front runner. There's not a person whose turn it is. It is completely open situation. And I just tried to list all the different candidates. And I had about 15, and none of them in a dominant position. It's there to be taken. And the Republican Party are looking for somebody who is likable.
A likable Republican. Name three.
Reagan was very likable.
Reagan.
Oh, yes, he was. Yes, he was. Eisenhower was very likable. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Somebody who's likable, somebody who appeals to women, and somebody who is under the age of 65.
Right. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Well, Marlene Perrin, you're likable. And you're a woman, and you're under the age of 65.
But she's not a Republican.
And she is a Republican.
And with all the sex scandals from all the various men who've occupied the White House, I think only women should be elected president.
So you see Christine Todd Whitman as a Republican
I'd like
nominee.
To see. I'd love to see her get a good shot. And I don't think.
Hold your breath.
No, I don't. I don't think it may be as easy for Al Gore as it might appear to be, because I think by then somebody's going to try to knock him off.
I think it all depends on how well the Clinton administration does. Of course, the people talk about on the Democratic side are Dick Gephardt, the House Minority Leader, mm-hmm. and Senator Chris Dodd.
The Gephardt thing is interesting because it just shows, again, how complete the Clintonite revolution has been in the party. I mean, back in 88, those of us on the left of the party opposed Dick Gephardt root and branch here with Simon and
Jackson. Now he's the left-wing
candidate.
Because
he was the DLC candidate. He said, we've got to stop Gephardt or the party will swing to the right. Now, with Al Gore, who was the point man, I understand, for welfare reform in the White House, is the heir apparent to Clinton, and we're reduced to the possibility of supporting Gephardt, who's had as many masks as there are Halloweens in terms of his political thing.
So Gephardt came into Congress as a pro-life.
Yeah, sure. He's been all over.
Strong supporter of a strong anti-communist, strong supporter of defense. And he had a retooling. They retooled him. They put him into the shop, and mm-hmm. he's a liberal now. He voted against the welfare reform.
Oh, strong, strongly.
Voted against NAFTA.
I mean, it's just there's no progressive, whether you're top to bottom of the Democratic Party, there's no candidate recruitment, there's no social forces at work for progressive leadership in the New Deal tradition.
You make me feel better all the time. Anyway, I'll give another Sanders.
Another exclusive. It's that third one.
Keep your eye on an all Tennessee year 2000 election, possibly.
Alexander against Gore?
Thompson.
Fred right. Thompson. Actor.
Had one already.
You don't like Reagan, but Reagan was very popular. 6'7".
He's not appealing to women.
He is.
wait a second.
Thompson,
the woman on the group is saying he's not appealing to women, and you're saying he is appealing to women.
I can't believe you're saying that.
I don't know what he looks
like. He's a hunk.
We're going to have you back here in 5 years, and he is not going to be the nominee. I absolutely guarantee it.
Right.
Should Iowa and New Hampshire be first in the selection process, or are these states so different from the rest of the country?
I like Florida and California first because it's warmer.
That's where you want to be. Well, I don't know. I'm going to give you an exclusive, by the way. If you look at the votes on the state of Iowa in 1992, Clinton, Perot, and Dole, they exactly mirrored what the national totals were. So I think that we should remain first. We're a sensible state. And it isn't a big
no. I like coming here every 4 years. What am I doing here now?
It's an extra trip.
Yeah. All right.
There's a problem with this, though, that's going to cause a big hoo-ha one of these days, and that is that the state parties can't really be trusted to report the results correctly. I mean, the state parties are not impartial bodies in this, and they report the results from top to bottom, and they play them to the media to meet the East Coast newspaper deadlines. Mm-hmm. And it's very clear now that people are positioning themselves to be in control of these state parties, and one of these days we're going to have a scandal. We're going to have somebody reported as the winner who turns out not to be the winner, unless we turn this over to the auditors or somebody who can report them more impartially.
Well, I'm just hoping that in 4 years we get more of a spread of the medical use of marijuana. I know that's one of Jeff's big issues, and I know you as a conservative approve of this legalization.
No, I really don't. I'm a conservative, I'm not a libertarian, and when we have a lot more time, Gary, I'll explain you the difference.
All right, well, when you come back next time. We've got to wrap it up for now. It's been a pleasure having you here. I want to also say thank you to Jeff Cox of the Prairie Progressive, Marlene Perrin, columnist for the Cedar Rapids Gazette, and you, sir, Robert David Sanders Novak, I believe.
That's
and
right.
That is my exclusive. We have two Sanders on the Sanders Group. See you next time. Beep, 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 beep. Beep, 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 beep